Invictus Games. Хто представлятиме Україну на іграх в Торонто? Ці та інші матеріали в ефірі Громадського протягом найближчої години.
Ну, ситуація в тому, що ми з оператором слідства «Інфо» Кирилом поїхали знімати маєток одного з українських олігархів, який вже добудувався. Нам цікаво просто було для матеріалу відзняти це. Ми приїхали туди на таксі. Таксі лишили десь метрах, мабуть, 400 від точки, де ми хотіли знімати, бо там бездоріжжя, таксі сказав, я не поїду далі. Ми розклалися, ми зробили два підйоми дрону, ми красиво все відзняли, посадили його, жодних рухів, жодних автівок, жодних людей. І в той момент, коли ми підходили вже до таксі, почули перший постріл. Свист і побачили, як щось потрапляє в стовбур, власне, дерева. Таксист дуже спокійно сказав, що по нас стріляють. Сховався за колесом, дрібними перебіжками підкрався до своїх дверей, завів двигун. Ми вже закинули просто дрон в багажник, і тут почули ще три чи чотири аналогічних пострілів, але вже нижче, десь метр-півтора над автівкою. Ну, відповідно, рефлекс водія та, мені здається, будь-якої нормальної людини – це по газах і ходу звідти.
Тобто ми правильно розуміємо, що власне стріляли по вас, а не по дрону, тому що дрон вже був на землі.
Дрон уже був навіть майже в коробці для дрона. Тому я підозрюю, що побачили, що йдуть люди з дроном в руці, і подумали, що будуть зараз піднімати його. Тому вирішили таким чином, ну я не знаю, підозрюю, що полякати.
Ви можете розповісти, над яким матеріалом ви працювали і власне чому саме ви поїхали туди, що ви знімали?
Найобразливіше, що ми працювали навіть не над повноцінним сюжетом. Ми приїхали туди зняти будинок, який вірогідно належить Ренату Ахметову, який добудовується там поблизу, для того, щоб розмістити цей матеріал, відеоматеріал коротенький на нашій сторінці слідства інфо в Фейсбуці. Ну, власне, відзняли.
Про що сам матеріал? Тобто ви сказали, що це тізер, а власне так, сам матеріал
так,
про що?
Так. Ну, насправді, це матеріал, ну, це навіть не матеріал, це просто так, відеофакт розкішного будівництва на території колись заповідної зони, де, власне, доступу простим людям більше немає, ну, по великому рахунку, і давно вже немає. І ми хотіли спростувати тезу про те, що блокада нанесла тотальний удар по капіталам Рената Ахметова, у нього там не залишилося грошей, він уже починає ледь не бідувати. Ця мулька ходила декілька тижнів по соціальних мережах. Ну, ми побачили те, що гроші є, якщо добудовуються подібні будинки.
Поліція Київської області заявила, що вони вже зареєстрували відповідне провадження там, в загальному реєстрі. Чи контактували на основі повідомлень в ЗМІ? Чи контактували ви сьогодні з вами з цього приводу поліція і які, власне, були?
Взагалі вперше за 10 років моєї роботи журналістом поліція подзвонила мені сама. Не я дзвонив поліцію, вони мені. Вони попросили мене приїхати у вівторок вранці до них в Обухівський райвідділок і написати заяву, відповідно до якої вони і зареєструють. Я не знав про те, що вони вже зареєстрували на основі матеріалів у ЗМІ, тому що, ну, якщо чесно, я не відслідковував сьогодні це. Я обов'язково вівторок залюбки поїду. Якщо їм потрібні свідки, ми знайдемо цього таксиста, у нас є його номер. Я думаю, що він так само не відмовиться від свідчень.
А що ви робили після того, власне, коли почалися постріли? Ви сказали, що ви там сіли в автомобіль, що було далі?
Нічого, таксист просто вдарив по газах і мовчки топив до самого Києва під 200. Людина налякалася, це нормально. Самому, ну, дуже страшно, це не зона АТО, де ти, в принципі, чекаєш, що можуть бути такі ситуації. Це 15 кілометрів від Києва, це, ну, там дуже мирна територія. Ну і перший рефлекс, ну я не знаю, мабуть, журналістський, це написати пост в Фейсбуці. Ну, принаймні, якщо нас будуть добивати десь, то будуть знати, де ми знаходимося. Ну і відповідно після посту там почали зв'язуватися колеги, батьки подзвонили та запитали, чи все нормально. Ну, вони звикли до таких ситуацій.
Після того, як ви повернулися в редакцію, що ви робили?
Ми сіли одразу віддивлятися кадастрову карту, аби зрозуміти, з якого боку взагалі по нас стріляли. Тому що стріляли не з боку маєтку, який ми знімали, а з протилежного боку. Там знаходиться такий перелісок, річка і декілька житлових будинків. Ну, ми приблизно прикинули, звідки це могло вестися. Я не буду говорити, тому що, ну, якщо воно не так, то це буде клівета. Ну, але для себе ми, в принципі, зрозуміли, хто це може бути. І, ну, власне, ця ситуація дала подивитися на декларацію цієї людини ще раз. Можливо, ми її вкусимо.
Розуміючи, що це тільки ваші здогадки, що ви з'ясували, подивившись цей кадастровий реєстр, кому міг належати маєток, звідки потенційно по вас стріляли?
Не скажу, цього не буду говорити, тому що ця людина вірогідно працює в тій сфері, яка може дуже сильно засудити за неправдиві надання неправдивих відомостей, а тому ну там зайвий раз краще промовчати.
Останнє запитання. Які були ваші відчуття, коли власне це все почалося? Ви сказали, що коли в зоні АТО, то ви розумієте, що можна очікувати постріли. Коли ти знаходишся там в мирному Києві і по вас стріляють, відчуття зовсім інші.
Ну насправді про зону АТО я можу судити тільки з розповідей колег, тому що я не знаю, чи на щастя, чи на жаль, мені не пощастило знімати матеріалів в зоні бойових дій. Можу порівнювати тільки там ситуацію на Майдані. Ну страшно, ну людина, це ж нормальні людські якісь відчуття. Ну страшно, по тобі стріляють, ти або ховаєшся, або біжиш. Просто страшно. Ти не очікуєш, тим паче ти навіть не бачиш звідки. Ну і ти розумієш, що це не пневматична зброя, а це ну, вогнепальна. Метром нижче, не знаю.
В день 13 квітня в офісі Міжнародного центру перспективних досліджень відбулися обшуки. Їх влаштували співробітники прокуратури Автономної Республіки Крим спільно із силовиками Служби безпеки України. Це стало першим прецедентом обшуків в аналітичному центрі. Прокурори шукали докази у розслідуванні справи про державну зраду, де фігурує також народний депутат Андрій Артеменко. Він нібито передавав раднику президента США Майклу Фліну план заходів щодо нормалізації відносин між Україною та Росією для зняття санкцій з Російської Федерації. За версією слідства, саме керівник Міжнародного центру перспективних досліджень Василь Філіпчук розробив для Артеменка цей план.
Це кримінальне провадження було зареєстровано за статтею 111 «Державна зрада» Кримінального кодексу України за фактом закликів до передачі території Автономної Республіки Крим у тимчасову оренду Російської Федерації.
План Артеменка, про який написало у лютому газети «Нью-Йорк Таймс», передбачає нібито виведення з території окупованих Донецькою та Луганською областей російських військ. Натомість нібито українська влада має провести всенародний референдум і передати в оренду анексований Крим Російській Федерації на 50 або 100 років. Сам Філіпчук стверджує, що не розробляв для Артеменка ніяких планів і нібито взагалі бачив його лише тричі в житті.
Лютого 2014 року, я думаю, будь-яке розслідування електронних емейлів чи телефонних розмов немає жодного факту, жодної моєї розмови з ним, до жодної зустрічі, жодної обговорення якихось серйозних питань до 20 лютого, чи 18, чи 20 лютого уже цього року. Я з величезним інтересом прочитав публікації в американській, а потім в нашій пресі про те, що в січні місяці, про те, що Андрій Артеменко запропонував якийсь мирний план. Коли він повернувся в Україну, я його набрав і кажу, слухай, давай зустрінемося, розкажи мені, що до тебе за мирний план. Він пішов до мене в офіс, ми потім з ним ще зустрічалися декілька разів після цього. І я з задоволенням послухав його ідеї, які в нього були.
За словами наукового директора Інституту євроатлантичного співробітництва Олександра Сушка, озвучення Артеменком плану розробляв саме Міжнародний центр перспективних досліджень, а народний депутат використав їх як власні.
Сам факт того, що Філіпчук і його колеги писали тексти на цю тему, це не є секретом. Адже всі ці матеріали були оприлюднені. І були оприлюднені задовго до того, як з'явився оцей випадок з Артеменко, який там запозичив деякі елементи цього плану і фактично присвоїв їх. От. Але ну, всі, принаймні, хто в темі, знали, що там такі ідеї є, вони їх публічно обговорювали. Та вони, очевидно, більшості з нас не подобаються, ми їх не поділяємо.
Водночас Сушко переконаний, що обшуки в аналітичному центрі стануть небезпечним прецедентом для експертної діяльності в Україні.
Просто дійсно є багато людей, які можуть сказати, так їм і потрібно. Але це найгірше, що тільки може бути. Тому що якщо зараз суспільство буде толерувати такі речі, як цей випадок, то завтра прийдуть до інших, післязавтра до третіх.
–
Good evening from our headquarters in Kyiv. This is the Sunday show at Hromadske International, the only prime-time program explaining Eastern European geopolitical storm in English. And I'm Natalia Humanyuk. It's been 1 year since the Ukrainian Prime Minister Groysman was appointed. How much has he accomplished in terms of reforms? We'll be discussing his progress with experts. We'll take a closer look at the anti-corruption fight, Ukraine's energy independence, healthcare, and the number of reforms, and we'll look at how the preparations for Eurovision are taking shape. Please, we encourage you to check our webpage in English, but as well, there you can watch full reports, interviews, read our analysis, and please, we also encourage you to follow us on Twitter, which is updated 24/7, and I'll be back in a second. So it's 1 year since Groysman, Ukrainian Prime Minister, was appointed. There was a lot of questions after previous government of Arseniy Yatseniuk had resigned. So what would happen with the reforms? How fast would they be? The action plan of that government was to provide macroeconomic stabilization, create favorable conditions for business, to enforce rule of law and combat corruption, improve the quality of public administration and public service, restore security and citizens. But now we can check what's happening with that. We have experts. We have Oleksandr Sushko, who is a research director at Institute for Euro-Atlantic Cooperation, and Taras Shevchenko, who is director at Center for Democracy and Rule of Law. And both of you are, can speak on behalf of the reanimation reform package, who are advocating, providing, and keeping track on the reforms. So good evening.
Good evening. Hi.
The first, we of course prepared a number of the graph of the statistics, the number of institutions had looked what had been achieved and what hadn't been. And the first graph to show was the expert opinion that was done by the Ilko Kucherev Democratic Initiative Foundation in partnership with the Reanimation Package of Reforms. The question was, what, in your opinion, what has prevailed in the government activity, success or failures? There were, you know, 16% of the experts said there was an equal number of success and failures. I would say that majority had said that there were a lot more failures than success. Just 6% has said that successes has somewhat prevailed, and nobody said that there were a lot more success. We'll go in details into the particular fields, but in generally, what would be your assessment and how would you explain? You know, are we disappointed? Is it normal? What are the main things what we should know after this year of Volodymyr Groysman government?
I would be in that yellow field, that there was, I would say, more or less equal number of successes and failures. Why? Probably because I did not expect too much from that year. I'm not a person with too high expectations. And always when we speak about changes, it's important to think about the baseline for comparison. Are we comparing with ideal situation and with like ideal reforms, or we are comparing with baseline that was like the situation 2 or 3 years ago? If you compare with what was 2-3 years ago, then the progress is visible. If we compare with our ideal picture of ideal reforms in all the fields, then it looks like nothing achieved.
Alexander.
The output for the first year is quite comparable to my personal expectations, because a year ago we didn't have any illusions that there will be the perfect reformist government. When the government was created a year ago, it was clear that it is a hybrid government, in which coexist some reformers and also a lot of old-style people. And that was the basis for this government and for our prognosis, that we would have probably some achievements. However, there will be also a lot of inertia of the past, as there are not so there is not a critical mass of reformers in the government. So the maximum what we have expected is achievements in some particular areas where the critical mass of reform is realistically available. And then, so that we have what we have, and this is quite clear that this government reflects the political reality of Ukraine, where we have the old and new forces combined, working together, mixed, and there is no essential advantage of the reformist forces. So the Groysman government is a kind of a picture of a current political spectrum of Ukraine.
So the devil is in the details. So of course we have to look where we can search for success, and that's what the experts said. So we can look. This is introduction of e-declaration, but what we know, of course, that was a move of the civil society, not really by the government, to proceed with this reform. Transition to public procurement through the electronic system of Prozoro. So somehow we can say also that was something which had been started with the previous Minister Abramavičius and the others. The launch of the reform in the healthcare sector, raising the minimum wage, though it's dubious, we'll discuss that later. A progressive change in tax legislation, overall macroeconomic stabilization, continuation of decentralization, yet we know it's not that still moving forward, especially what we know so far, that part of the funds would be in the stabilization form. So it means if the money would be there, they would be there. And the government first year failures, we can speak about the energy sector reform, though there are other questions. We can go further: delay with the pension reform, increase in the minimum wage, delay with the land reform, and the poor business climate. We can also prepare, we had another graph, we would say that again we can show. So the good things are the procurement, e-declaration, establishment of the National Police of Ukraine, new anti-corruption institution, decentralization. So these reforms are going further. And as well, the failed reforms are called judicial reform, reform of internal affairs bodies, public service reform, tax reform, and anti-corruption reform. I would also ask to bring this chart. So what would be your assessment? What are the failures? What are the good things? What are something we can explain?
I can hardly say 100% that some area is total failure or total success. I may say that even in these areas where the experts mostly indicate failure, there are also some achievements. For example, if you look at the energy sector policy, during the last year we have some accomplishments, and which is reflected, for example, in the annual report of Naftogaz Ukraine, which for the first time in its history became a profit company. And there is much more transparency in the governance of Naftogaz, which at least reduced the scope of corruption in this area. However, certainly all the things are not accomplished. And now there are some turbulence in Naftogaz. There are lots of rumors that the supervisory board may be some way collapse. And the same when it comes to the civil service reform. I also can't say that there is a total failure, because all things just started this year, and we have certain processes which totally new for Ukrainian political culture. For example, these competitions for high-level public officials. Yes, we are not satisfied with all the outputs. However, there is really new practices which are introduced, and this brings in you some sort of new culture. It does not bring immediate result when it comes to the full efficiency of the new officials, full transparency. There are lots of some suspects, corrupt people also there. But anyway, this is a progress, and this, unfortunately, this is not that progress which can be easily identified by the external observers, including the million of people, which in the most cases just can't see this. And here we will come to the issue of communication, which is poor on the side of the government. Here we come to the issue of failure of parliamentary coalition to proceed with next phases of legislations in some areas. And also we have a phenomenon of our lobbyist groups who are not interested in continuation of reforms. And then we have this continuous fighting between those who are in favor of next steps and those who try to keep status quo.
So what are the things to follow and point out as the success and something which could be done much better?
I think the most interesting is raise of minimum wage, because it's probably one of unique reform that equally is considered as plus and as failure, according to opinion and the charts that you just showed. But I would like to mark also, like to my mind, that we are still failing with reform of prosecutor's office and judiciary. And with judiciary, we've done a lot on the level of legislation. There is ongoing competition for the Supreme Court. But we cannot say that that's success, because there are quite a lot of warning statements now about the fact that the competition is quite close with a lot of information that is confidential. And there are a lot of suspicious that it will not be real competition, but just reallocating of some judges from one court to another. I think that the biggest influence in the long term, especially like in more like political field, will be electronic declarations. Even though generally public would probably think that's negative reform, it's negative for them because they had negative emotions after they learned all this information about cash and about assets of public officials. But on the long term, it's really, again, about changing culture, because for future politicians, for future governors, they have a clear signal that if they want anytime in the future to go to be a minister or a head of administration or even middle-level civil servant, their assets shall be clear. They will need to report about what they own, where they live, how big house is some judge owns, yeah, and could he or she explain why he got this 600 meters, square meters of house. And that will affect the practice and behavior of these people for a long-term period.
And of course, a lot of people would say that there is no such reform as anti-corruption, because it's about everything. It's more than that. But still, there were a lot of institutions created to fight corruption. We're speaking about a national anti-corruption bureau, or for instance, the agency to prevent anti-corruption. So though this year it was all about that, yet there were a lot of cases. We could speak about the whole thing about the Roman Nasirov case, the head of the State Fiscal Service of Ukraine, who is temporarily revealed of his duties while under investigation of embezzlement. So in general, how would you assess this particular, you know, direction? I wouldn't say this is one reform.
I think, first of all, that the new institutions, at least they working better than the old institutions. So that was a good solution, that at certain point the decision was taken to create a new institution and try to implement some new policies in them. Certainly there is no illusion that from the very beginning such institutions work properly. It almost never happened. For example, now there are many debates on the Romanian experience, which is a huge progress in anti-corruption policy, including imprisonment of the hundreds of corrupt officials. But we sometimes forget that in Romania, these institutions were established 10 and even more years ago. And for many years, they were not so much efficient. And it took time until these institutions collected enough of institutional capacity, and then the leadership was appointed with a certain political will. So probably we also need some time to let them consolidate their capacity.
And of course, this year there was a big debate in Romania that that particular anti-corruption bureau, if it would be chosen, to punish in particular those with a political, clear political affiliation. So there is always there is this discussion. And that would be exactly the question. We also talked to a number of the prosecutors from foreign countries. They are coming, they are consulting you from Guatemala, from, you know, those who were successful. And they say that there is always the risk that this successful work of the independent institutions could be stopped by, you know, general prosecutor office or the other state institution could somehow hinder that. The question with Groysman government was always how independent is him from the president, how all the institutions are independent from President Poroshenko, for instance, general prosecutor office or the others. So what is your opinion? What is your assessment at this stage? Are these institutions really independent? Could really the government, the president, influence on them and other law enforcement agencies?
I think we should really differentiate those institutions that shall be independent, then where president shall have no influence and political parties shall have no influence, like prosecutor's office or judiciary. With government, with Groysman, where it's absolutely logical that there is influence and connections with the president. They are from the same party. There is also kind of like political party program, and it's absolutely normal that they work in line. Moreover, we see that when government, when head of the government and president are from the same party, they can cooperate, not compete and fight. So in this regards, this may provide for more effective managerial work and better possibility to get decisions, in parliament, yeah, to have legislation passed as well, but also not to, like, I don't know, fight about who shall be appointed as someone for the position where both prime minister and president have some authority.
What we also have interesting in this survey that about who are the reform pushing forces and the barriers. So 99% of experts say that civil society organization and volunteers are those who are pushing reforms. 63% it's up to the Western countries. Then we see the government, president, population. And as the barriers, we can see that oligarchs, bureaucracy, public officials, law enforcement bodies, and as well the president and the political forces are the barriers for the progress. So really, would you agree or disagree with that? And also, how could it last for a while if we really see that outside forces are those who push, if we speak about the civil society and the West?
Yes, that's true that it is not about Western countries as such, but it is about Ukrainian international commitments. So this is nothing which Western countries may impose if Ukraine does not subscribe. So in many cases, it was a conditionality. For example, in order to get visa-free travel to Europe, Ukraine was obliged to implement certain reforms. So this is not so much influence directly of the Western countries, but the influence of the obligations which Ukraine wants and some achievements which Ukraine want to get. So this is a conditionality. And first of all, it is about IMF, European Union, but also United States. So this works. However, now it's not so strong as it was a couple of years ago. For example, involvement of the United States now is not so clear that it was under Obama administration. So there is no more Biden any longer. So there is weakening this leverage. And the other things, Taras and I, we are working in the civil society. So I may tell you frankly that I would not put 99%. Yes, we know that civil society is also heterogeneous. It is not one single actor which acts as one. So there are not a lot of groups of interests. And I see that in the civil society, we also have growing tensions, debates, many groupings are around. So it is, again, it is not so easy as it was immediately after Maidan, when there was a quite consolidated civil society. Now it is more not so clear. I mean, so there are more diversity in the civil society.
But how resilient is also the civil society? Because there are also a lot of questions which had been raised after the new amendments to the law, which set the obligation for the NGO, anti-corruption NGO, to declare their assets as well. You know, and there was a big debate. So really, we sometimes here see that there are the issues between some of the groups. There are the issues that, you know, that the resilience can last forever, and some of the, you know, creative forces could be also the forces which can, you know, do something wrong. So how much we can still, you know, be progressive and I would say constructive if we speak about the civil society, and what are the risks?
You know, after Maidan, we've united as RPR, Reforms Coalition, and I would say that first year after Maidan was the year of big energy, consolidation, remembering like our previous experience, and also it was a year when we had many prepared decisions that we prepared like long ago, when there was no window of opportunity to actually implement that or to put it through parliament. And currently we're in a situation when those like resources that were prepared in the past, we do not have them anymore, and we need to develop new policies, with new decisions, new draft legislations, and the process of developing this is quite hard, and that's where more debates are happening. For example, by 2014, we had already well decided how we see the reform of public service broadcasting. Everything was decided, there was draft law prepared, and it was just needed to be voted in parliament. But if we now start, I don't know, debates about land reform or language issue, the draft law on state language, then this is only the process of developing the decision, of finding consensus. And yes, that's harder, that creates more like disputes, but that's normal process. And it's more normal for developed country to take some time to come to decision, not to do it immediately.
I would like also to show this survey, the results on the public readiness to tolerate material hardships for the sake of reforms. Of course, there is less tolerance since, you know, so we see that there were more people ready to tolerate for as long as it's needed. There were people ready to tolerate not longer than a year. Of course, are those who say that they are not ready because material status is already intolerable. As well, what is interesting, we can draw your attention on, for instance, such issues as the land reform, which is, of course, would be used by the populists, because it's probably the reform where the government has shown so far the less readiness to do something, as we can see from what the Prime Minister has said, that not even a centimeter of the Ukrainian land will be given to foreigners. There is a lot of criticism on that. We also can see that there is sometimes the criticism on the, it's not directly connected to Volodymyr Groysman, but for instance, how in public fear the whole issue with the head of the National Bank of Ukraine, Valeria Gontareva, had been discussed. I would encourage, we wouldn't discuss that in details, but on our webpage you can find the analysis about the seven main facts about Valeria Gontareva, the outgoing head of National Bank of Ukraine. So some of the things for which she had been praised had been criticized by some of the political forces. So just general question. In this particular political context, when there are some, you know, always the plays, play with the voters, do you see how ready is the government to do, you know, hard things which are unpopular but necessary? Or would they be ready to, you know, to still play for the political, for the votes, I would say, in particularly if we speak about this government?
I think that there is usually when it comes approaching to elections, the readiness of doing unpopular things are going down. So uncertainty produces uncertainty with the future of the coalition produces these risks. And in fact, we have very fragile coalition. And formally, the next elections just had to happen just in 2 years. But the atmosphere in this society is like the, we have just next autumn elections. And the politicians very much sensitive to that. And that is why the chances for unpopular steps are not very high. However, it is just a wrong perception that reforms are necessary unpopular. So there are some reforms which are unpopular for many people, but the biggest risk is the reforms which are unpopular for the big guys, when they start to block using their leverages, because they do not want to lose a comfortable status quo. And here there is a risk, a combination of the total distrust, which is visible in the society, and even irritation, and so lack of certainty in the population. And at the same time, interest groups. Those who are just feel good with the existing system, and they are resisting. And now we see this growing resistance in many, many areas, makes some trouble. The problem is that there is an identification of priorities. However, the problem is that we do not have a the government just has certain priorities, but this is not an overall picture of the coherence of changes. Sometimes we see that some particular reformers move their things forward, but without harmonization of specific policy areas, it's hard to achieve.
Taras, we can speak this week about the big success of the election of the head of the new public broadcasting. There were a lot of concerns if the elections would take place. In the end, there was an independent candidate, Zurab Alasania, had been chosen and by the independent board. So really how difficult it was. Was it really whether really a lot of concerns and what it all mean?
Thank you for your question. Indeed, we now are on a very important stage. After creation of public service broadcasting company in January this year, that's for the first time ever, the supervisory board is making a competition, and we made a decision this week that after the competition, Zurab Alasania, whom I myself consider as really independent candidate, was elected for this position. It was quite dramatic because another candidate who, like in the first round, was with boss had 8 votes in favor when 9 votes were needed to get this position. He is existing public servant and he works for government, and he was dealing with that reform as well. But for independence of the TV channel and radio channels and all the information that shall be broadcast. My own consideration that the results of these elections is good for society and for this institution, because independence and like the core reform is about not to have TV channel and radio channels that are state, like belonging to state and reporting to the state, but that looks at the society and works for society.
So to finalize, another graph shows who are the most successful ministers according to the opinion of the experts again. Here we have the Minister of Healthcare of Ukraine, Ulyana Suprun. It's Oleksandr Danilyuk, who is a Minister of Finance of Ukraine, the Minister of Justice, Pavlo Petrenko, Minister of Education and Science, and Volodymyr Omelyan, the Minister of Infrastructure. So these are the, though there were a lot of debates in the Ukrainian society, in the Ukrainian civil society regarding those people. Before we go to finalize, I also would like to propose the quote of the Matila Yakub. She is a senior health economist from the World Health Organization Regional Office for Ukraine, who would give a bit more a comment on what is happening with the healthcare reform, and with that we will summarize.
We are very pleased with progress. There is so much progress since the last time I was here in November. The Ministry of Health team has developed a lot of further conceptual documents, legislation, decrees, regulatory documents to implement the National Health Service, primary healthcare reform, reform in public health and medicines. The National Health Service will function as a so-called executive agency. And the main function of this agency is to purchase healthcare services, to make contracts between this agency and healthcare providers, hospitals, primary healthcare providers. Today, Ukraine is a very difficult economic situation. So there are genuine constraints how much money we can put into the healthcare system. And it affects not just healthcare, but the education sector, the pension sector. Of course, it would be much better if we doubled this amount or tripled this amount. But where will the money come from? We have to continue to increase the funding, especially for primary healthcare, but we have to live within the reality of our means. There is a lot of money spent in the Ukrainian health system, not well spent. It's spent on interventions or medicines that are not improving the health of the people. It's spent for the maintenance of infrastructures that don't produce much benefit for the people. So we can spend the money we have much better for the benefit of the people, and this new system will allow you to do that.
So I think we will summarize. I think we all, and especially you answering on the questions of in different international conferences at this stage. So what is good, what is not? We always hear about some kind of a Ukrainian fatigue. People would like to propose and give the examples if something is successful, but of course there is a lot of criticism. So really finalizing this discussion, so what are the things to watch? What, for instance, you will be watching and would give advice to look closely with the current stage of the reforms?
What is important to me is that this government has introduced some really new practices, which is a kind of the public policy tradition, which never existed in Ukraine at all. Groysman's government started from the very correct steps to elaborate its program in close cooperation with the civil society publicly through the normal process of public policy making. Yes, this practice is far from being perfect now, but this is a step in correct direction, and it affects the whole policy. It is not about one particular policy area. So here we need to learn and move forward these new traditions that they tried to introduce, and then to help if there is a good political will on the side of at least part of the government, and particularly Groysman himself, to engage. So not just to have some people to listen to him, but also to talk. And this is, I hope that this is sincere on the side of Prime Minister.
I think that it's quite important that some processes, even though we don't see already like final solutions, but they started. Like recently, just a few days ago, started a process of selecting of 600 new judges for lower courts. And that's really something that we need to follow, because we only had judges that left judiciary, but we didn't have anyone new entering judiciary within 3 years. And 600 judges, for example, like in local courts in Kyiv, in some courts, 25% of judges missing. If we speak about what society is unhappy most of all, it's judiciary. And it's not about bad PR. It's about actual change. And I really hope that actual change in judiciary would be happening. And that's what I suggest to follow.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for providing your analysis, and we'll definitely would follow more. And before I say goodbye to you, I would say that there is another, of course, segment, sector. It's the Ukraine's energy sector reform. There are, of course, the discussion, should it be praised or doubted. Of course, we have the successful cases of Naftogaz, but as Oleksandr said, there are issues so far. But our colleagues from the Reform Watch program has investigated the gas production, what's happening with the gas production sector, especially in regards of the gas extraction in Ukraine. So their story is about how to make Ukraine a major gas exporter again.
Коли людина отримала 15-20 тисяч гривень, вона все одно виймала з компанії. І вона виймала не той рівень зарплати, який зараз у нас встановлений. Вона виймала в 100 тисяч разів більше. Чому? Тому що вона ж не для себе виймала. Ви ж теж це розумієте. Вона відносила ці гроші наверх. І так працювала вся система. З цих компаній годувалися цілі політичні сили.
Завдання, яке стоїть перед Прохоренком, це програма 2020. Її суть проста. До 2020 року «Укргазвидобування» має збільшити видобуток газу до 20 мільярдів кубометрів на рік і повністю забезпечити потреби України власним газом. Для цього йому треба зруйнувати старі схеми, через які відмивалися гроші. Прохоренко називає цифру 3 мільярди гривень. Стільки крали у «Укргазвидобуванні» на рік. Зараз один з пріоритетів – розірвати так звані договори про спільну діяльність з приватними інвесторами.
Вони просто були зроблені для вимивання грошей з компанії. Тобто мова йшла не про розвиток, їм не потрібен розвиток. Їм просто потрібно було взяти свердловини «Укргазвидобування», качати цей газ, продавати його, отримувати надприбутки і все. І потім «Укргазвидобування» майже нічого не отримувало від цих схем. І все.
Eight enterprises were working with «Укргазвидобування» under the contracts on common gas production. The most scandalous are the companies of fugitive MP Onishchenko. He was selling the gas extracted to his shell companies at a price two times lower than the market one. Ukrgazvidobuvanya was receiving part of this understated sum as provided by the contract, and then gas was being sold at market price. In such a way, Onishchenko's companies were not only getting their share of the profit, but in addition were taking 60% of state profit.
Для того, щоб наростити видобуток газу, треба весь час бурити нові свердловини і оновлювати вже існуючі запаси, яких постійно виснажуються. Це природній процес. Проте всі ці кроки треба погоджувати із землевласниками.
У нас, як в державному підприємстві, дуже мало прав. Тобто землевласник з якихось причин, скажімо, може нас не пустити. Да, з нас ніхто не знімає питання екологічної рекультивації, ніхто не знімає питання, що все після нас все залишалося б в нормальному стані. З нас цих питань не знімають. Але з другої сторони, коли ми ходимо по кругу навколо кожного землевласника, так, а може так. А нам треба вже заїхати на ту чи іншу свердловину, провести ті чи інші роботи. Роботи термінові, від яких залежить видобуток, від яких залежить план. Виробниче завдання – це взагалі газ.
Найбільшим розпорядником земель Полтавщини є Полтавська обласна рада. Протягом року її депутати блокують видачу «Укргазвидобуванню» ліцензій на освоєння нових родовищ. Вони вимагають, щоб частина ренти за видобутий в області газ йшла до місцевого бюджету. До речі, у Верховній Раді відповідний законопроект вже пройшов перше читання.
Обласна рада не блокує рішення питання, вона пропонує шляхи виходу. Але є побоювання того, що кошти від ренти будуть спрямовані не до спеціального фонду, як ми пропонуємо, а до загального. Тобто вони будуть фінансувати зарплати там, педагогам, медикам. Наша пропозиція все ж таки хоча б частину, щоб це було у спецфонді, щоб це був фонд розвитку.
Село Сенча відділяють від обласного центру 130 кілометрів розбитих доріг. Цей колишній райцентр Полтавської області переживає не найкращі часи. Але незабаром тут все може змінитися, адже на території Сенчі знаходяться газові свердловини. І зміниться, звичайно, якщо закон про розподіл ренти ухвалять.
Gas production is profitable for everyone except the local authorities. The state receives cubic meters of gas and rent payments, which is a portion of gas production company profits. Private investors receive money from the gas sold. Local authorities, where gas extraction takes place, receive nothing. Bill 3038 is supposed to change this. It was adopted in the first reading in early November. According to this, 5% of rent payments are to be directed to the local budget, 1.5% to the regional budget, 1.5% to the district or community budget, 2% to the budget of a village or town. Therefore, the Poltava region can receive about 55 million hryvnias for rent payment each month. A region and district in the territory of which gas extraction takes place will be receiving 16.5 million hryvnias, the village or town 22 million hryvnias. But even this is not a final version. Members of Parliament from the Petro Poroshenko bloc suggest reducing payments that are to be directed to the village or town budget twice and redirecting them to the budget of the region or district.
Вам доводиться постійно шукати спонсорів, але тут раз у вас буде, наприклад, кільканадцять, кількадесят мільйонів гривень. Вже є уявлення. От ви сказали, що головне це звичайно водойм.
Перше вода, дороги. Потім дуже давно і давно запущено, це не тільки в Сінчі, це по всій Україні, у сільських населених пунктах запущена робота з молоддю. Це і з меншою віковою групою, це підростки, потім вже такий більш юний возраст, щоб для дітей що зробити, щоб вони не сиділи там, де алкоголь продається, а для них, якщо зробити щось, щоб їх туди заманити, це треба вложити кошти. У нас дом культури прекрасний. Потім ось одне здання стоїть, це бивше здання універмага. Воно, розуміє, не рентабельне, зараз воно пусте стоїть. Будь ласка, можна на тій базі зробити дуже багато для молоді. Там можна зробити і секції, можна зробити і дискотеки, відпочинку, вечора, що угодно зробити можна.
У вас, каже, ідеї є?
Ну, повна ідея, аби тільки, щоб матеріально їх поплатити треба.
And Ukraine has gained the chance to host the Eurovision contest 2017 after winning the competition last year with a politically charged song by Jamala. The grand final will take place in Kyiv on the 13th of May. 43 countries will be taking part. Approximately 30,000 tickets have been sold so far, while our correspondent had went to see how the construction of the main stage is taking place and what we need to watch out.
No, sorry.
No problem. Ми знаходимося в міжнародному виставковому центрі. Так виглядає головна сцена Євробачення. Вона ще монтується. А от на цьому місці будуть стояти стільці, які приїдуть до Києва з Львівської арени.
All lights are has been installed and most of them are operational. We are still building, adding some stuff into the stage. We're completing the all the video elements that goes into the stage.
Продано приблизно 30 тисяч квитків. Приблизно 19 тисяч квитків заброньовані для делегацій країн-учасників, партнерів та спонсорів, і близько 21 тисячі квитків ще є у продажу чи надійдуть до продажу.
The U.S. State Secretary Tillerson had met his Russian counterpart Lavrov, and at the same time, a bit before, the U.S. president had enforced strike against Syria because of the use of the chemical weapon. The Russians have responded by suspending the agreement between the American and Russian militaries about coordination of air operations over Syria. We talked to Stephen Pfeiffer, a senior fellow at the Center of the United States and Europe at the Brookings Institution, to explain how all this can influence U.S.-Russian relations and as well what Trump's Syria politics means for our region.
No, well, I think the cruise missile strikes against Syria were designed to send Syria a message, which is that the Trump administration is going to react if Syria uses chemical weapons. Remember, back in 2013, Syria supposedly got rid of all of its chemical weapons. And I think the president has sent a message. It's a limited message. I mean, I don't think he's trying to bring down the Assad regime, but he is saying that certain actions the United States won't tolerate. I think it was a one-time response to the Syrian government's use of chemical weapons. At this point, you know, I don't think we can draw conclusions whether this is intended to be something broader or not. The Russians have responded by suspending the agreement between the American and the Russian militaries about coordination of air operations over Syria. That's a very unwise move because it raises the risk of miscalculation. But we'll see. I mean, Secretary of State Tillerson is supposed to be in Moscow. I'm sure this issue is going to come up. But it's something that, in a way, you know, if the Russians were watching what the president said on Wednesday when he talked about the Syrian use of chemical weapons, you know, it shouldn't have been a surprise. It's the cooperation between the United States and Russia to eliminate Syrian chemical weapons destroyed a lot more chemical weapons than an American airstrike would have done. But I think it was a mistake because it cost him a lot of international credibility. You shouldn't draw a red line unless you're prepared to respond if the other side crosses it. The president has a lot of authority as commander-in-chief. And I guess I would say that over the last 60 years, Congress has probably let its authority be diluted. Because in the past, Congress has not insisted. And so Congress now, I think, has a hard time objecting. There is, under the War Powers Act, a requirement for the president to inform Congress when he uses force like this. But over the last 50, 60 years, Congress has let some of that, its power to make war, shift to the presidency. And that's, it'll be hard, I think, for Congress to recover that. My guess is that on the particular airstrike, you're going to see a lot of bipartisan support. I mean, the Republicans will support President Trump because he's their president. And I think a lot of Democrats will say, it's an appropriate response to the use of chemical weapons. For example, Tony Blinken, who was the Deputy Secretary of State in the Obama administration, has already come out and said it was an appropriate act. So I think this particular strike will have broad support, but you know, we'll have to see what the broader Trump policy towards Syria is until we can determine whether or not that's going to have support from the Democrats as well as Republicans.
We would like to draw your attention to the untold stories of the prisoners of Eastern Ukrainian war, the war between Russia and Ukraine, which is taking place in the Ukrainian Donbas. 2 years ago, still in February 2015, after the right exactly when the ceasefire had been signed, the ceasefire which we call Minsk II, there were five Ukrainian servicemen taken into prison. Two of them had been freed after 50 days. One had managed to escape. Two servicemen are still there in captivity after 800 days. And we talked to Yulia Korenkova, who is the wife of one of them. How is it to live with the husband who is in prison for more than 2 years? With every single day, she's hoping for her husband to be released, though it's not really promising. So with this story, I leave you so far. Please watch the full interviews and read more analysis at our webpage, and I will be back soon.
I was waiting for his call because I knew. I wanted to let him know that I'd received the CD and the wedding album, but I couldn't get hold of him. When he called me back at 5:27 p.m. from an unknown number, he told me that I'd been taken prisoner and told me not to worry. Two men died, two others were badly injured, and five were taken prisoner. Two were released after 50 days. They were allowed to make calls every now and again, once a month or two. Of course, they were short conversations. They said nothing about themselves. It may sound strange, but I've gotten used to it, to the fact that my husband is a private man. He doesn't say much about his work or being in captivity. I haven't heard any information. no complaints from him. The only thing he was interested in was the Minsk agreements. We lived from Minsk talk to Minsk talk. Each time we hoped they'd come to an agreement there. And today is the 745 days. It's been 3 years.
45 діб. Третій рік. Хлопці. Саме головне – це хлопці. Ми бачили хлопців, що вони живі.
The most important thing is our guys. They are the most important. They are alive.
Ну от...
When we received those letters, I recognized my husband's handwriting. We have neither heard nor seen them in a long time. When you receive a letter and you know that he's alive, it's hard when you struggle to keep your head above water and it's all for nothing. We've had no results in 3 years. It's hard realizing that you're unable to help one of your own. It's hard and very terrifying. But we can't give up. For their sake, we can't give up. If we give up and do nothing, someone will benefit from it. We can't let that happen. Sooner or later, it will end. Wars always end. It's just a question of time. Sooner or later, both sides will come to an agreement. I hope that they will not give up. In the letter, I told him and the other guys to keep their spirits up. We deserve to be happy, to live in peace. We deserve to live in a great country. Those guys, our heroes, they deserve respect. They deserve it.
В ефірі «Громадське важливо» – найкращі матеріали громадського на актуальні теми. У цьому випуску. У Міжнародному центрі перспективних досліджень 13 квітня відбувся обшук у справі про держзраду. Це перший обшук аналітичних установ в історії України. Про те, до яких наслідків це може призвести, в матеріалі «Громадського».